dignitaries representing the region, including the cities of Colonial Heights, Hopewell,
it's not on, Sam.
So we lost power.
USA Garrison, Fort Lee, represent the United States military, and Lieutenant Colonel Stephen Caldwell, British Army Liaison Officer to CASCOM, Fort Lee, representing British forces, who will deliver, respectively, two components of this commemoration. The first conveying a brief history of the Battle of Petersburg, and second, a eulogy for British Major General William Phillips, whose death occurred in Petersburg in May 1781. To the daughters and sons of the American Revolution, to the attendant descendants of John Bannister, one of America's founding fathers and builder of this historic property, Battersea. To the dedicated and enthusiastic reenactors and the public who have come to enjoy this 18th century experience, and to our Fort Lee family as guests and participants who have helped make this event a reality.
I think this is working out. Now I don't have to use my big boy voice. Hey, what an awesome day. And it's great to have everybody here. And I would really like to welcome everybody that helped participate in this. Vice Mayor, thank you for those words. It's also great to have Senator Dance out here, as well as my British counterpart. And, you know, a little bit of a heads up, you know, as he stated, I'm going to give a little bit of a history on the Battle of Petersburg. But as Colonel Caldwell has reminded me three or four times already, they did win this one. So just a little bit of a spoiler alert on that one, just to lay the groundwork before we get going on this. You know, but as I was getting ready to come here today, I couldn't help reflect, and I was even talking to Carla, my fiance out there, about the history of this entire region. Some of the most formative and poignant times in our history, in our nation's history, have unfolded within miles of where we are right here, and some of it right here on this very spot that we're sitting right now. And this event commemorates one of our earliest examples of that history. Because somewhere in this city lie the remains of both Virginia militiamen and British soldiers, all who gave their lives in service to their respective countries some 235 years ago. History shows that at sunset on the evening of 24 April 1781, Major General William Phillips, force of about 2,500 British and Hessian soldiers, and we also talked about we should have brought our German LNO too, because if we had Hessian soldier involvement, we should have brought them also, had landed at City Point, which is right over here in Hopewell. Their prime objective was Petersburg, since at that time it was serving as a military depot for both the state and continental forces. Then, as the morning of dawned of the 25th, four regiments of Brigadier General Mulholland's Virginia Militia formed two lines of defense on the eastern edges of Petersburg and the village of Blandford, which at that time was a separate town east of Petersburg. And around midday, those two armies met in mortal combat for more than 3 hours. And although the heavily outnumbered Virginians valiantly contested the capture of Petersburg until the overwhelming numbers and firepower of the British Army forced their subsequent retreat across the Appomattox River right behind us into Chesterfield County, for the next 3 weeks, the area between Petersburg and Richmond became a battleground for the Americans and the British, each fighting for their individual causes. Until on the 9th of May, the British Army once again occupied Petersburg, where they were greeted by a bombardment from Lafayette's artillery, which at that time was positioned north of the river in what is now Colonial Heights. And I'm pretty sure it wasn't where the mall's at right now, but somewhere over there, Colonial Heights area. On the 13th of May, Major General William Phillips, commander of the combined British forces in Virginia, died of virulent fever as the shells from Lafayette's guns burst nearby. 2 days after General Phillips' death, Lord Charles Cornwallis and his troops marched into Petersburg to merge his forces with those of Phillips. still occupying Petersburg, at which time many of Cornwallis' troops were encamped right here on the grounds of Battersea for a number of days. The Battle of Petersburg was, in fact, the prelude to the momentous events to follow in the next 6 months at Yorktown, Virginia, where the United States of America would ultimately achieve its freedom. See, we eventually get there. And ironically, the subsequent 235 years have fostered one of the greatest nations on earth and perpetuated man's never-ending quest for freedom. But it also brought about a unique and ever-binding friendship between the then-entrenched cousins of the American Revolution, the United States of America and the United Kingdom. So hereby be it known that this weekend-long event of the 16th and 17th of 2016 of April commemorates the 235th anniversary of the 1781 Battle of Petersburg. And I will be followed by my counterpart from the awesome British Army, Major or Lieutenant Colonel Caldwell. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, honored guests, thank you for this opportunity to speak today. And I'd like to thank Colonel Brooks yet again for giving me a fantastic introduction. So it's my pleasure now to give you a eulogy for Major General William Phillips. Now, General Phillips was one of very few British officers at this time who raised the general officer rank by his ability alone. In 1746, aged 15, he entered the Military Academy at Woolwich and then served in the Royal Artillery, where he had a distinguished career. Indeed, his service at the Battle of Minden, back in Europe, in 1759, consolidated his reputation as an excellent officer. He subsequently rose to be the Commander of Artillery at Woolwich and the Lieutenant Governor of Windsor Castle. And indeed, he was also elected as a Member of Parliament. So in 1775, when hostilities broke out in the American colonies, Phillips, then a Brigadier General, was sent to Canada to command all artillery in that province. Displaying the greatest leadership and courage, he was promoted to Major General in 1776 and assigned as Deputy Commander to Lieutenant General Burgoyne. Now, after the disastrous Battle of Saratoga, disastrous for the Brits at least, in 1777, Burgoyne returned to Britain whilst Phillips took command of the now surrendered Convention Army, which was marched down to Charlottesville. Whilst there, Phillips worked tirelessly for the welfare of his own men. And of note, both he and his fellow officers were frequent guests at Monticello, home clearly of Thomas Jefferson, then Governor of Virginia. And in 1780, after several years, Major General Phillips was exchanged for the American Major General Benjamin Lincoln. And so Phillips, having returned to active duty, now supported Lieutenant General Lord Cornwallis' operations here in, down in North Carolina. His task was to destroy the American logistic lines through central Virginia. Now Phillips successfully achieved this mission with the same diligence and resourcefulness that characterized his entire 35-year service to the Crown. Tragically for him, 2 weeks after the culmination of this campaign, he fell violently ill with a fever and was forced to relinquish command to his deputy, the infamous Brigadier General Benedict Arnold. So on 13th of May 1781, aged 50, Major General Phillips died at Bolingbroke, the Petersburg home of Mrs. Bolling. And later that night, he was buried in an unmarked grave somewhere in Blandford Cemetery, and he remains there to this day. And so Major General Phillips' abilities gained him the highest regard from his contemporaries. Thomas Jefferson described him as the proudest man of the proudest nation on earth, whilst Captain Ewald of the German Jägers described him as worthy of commanding men. He drove everyone zealously to his duty, but he was the most pleasant, unselfish, and courteous man in the world. Moreover, to ensure the welfare of Petersburg and Chesterfield County, Phillips ordered that private property and those American individuals who had not taken up arms were to be under the protection of his troops, and thus he saved Petersburg from war's common devastation following the battle fought here. And so in 1914, the Francis Bland Randolph chapters of the Daughters of the American Revolution erected a cenotaph to his memory near the south door of Blandford Church. High praise indeed, but truly fitting, given the subsequent reconciliation of our two great nations. Thank you very much.
present the commemoration wreaths in memory of the daughters of the American.
Shoulder your arms.
In memory and special tribute from the Battersea Foundation.
Continental Congress from 1777 to 79. He was a framer and signer of the Articles of Confederation of July 9th, 17. 17-
Oh, okay, so then
so
I
you hold it, and then you start.
Files, march! To portray the British force as well. What we'd like to do for just a few minutes is to tell you a little bit about the cavalry or the dragoons that were used in the American Revolution. They had one part of three major roles, and each of you will explain a little bit about those different roles. The first role, the cavalry, since we had, as he alluded to, these 1,400 pound friends, the horses could go on a good day in about 8 strides, 35 or 40 miles an hour. And they weighed anywhere from 1,000 to 1,400 pounds. So if you were really tough and strong, unless you could take out a 1,400 pound linebacker coming at you at 20 miles or 30 miles an hour, you couldn't be able to stand still and keep your position. So they use the horses a lot for reconnaissance and for fighting the enemy, but not so much as what we think of as like charging forward and fighting. They use them a lot for carrying messages and for outposts because they could see what was going on and would come back and inform the commander in this case. So reconnaissance, that role is part of finding the enemy. So when you think of cavalry, you saw the infantry out here, they would fix the enemy. They would get them fixed and fight them
but finding the cavalry was the job of the American Dragoons. And as you can see, we got three guys that are dressed as American Dragoons, and two guys, you'll hear about in just a second, they're dressed as British Dragoons.
Yeah.
They're really pretty good guys. Anyway, yeah. thank you for your participation. Exactly. We appreciate that. So the different aspects, we just want to go over the cavalry. We'll be explained to you in just a second, and we'll have some picture opportunities afterwards if you want to get your picture taken with the horses. But first of all, I just want to remind you, the role of the cavalry in the American Revolution was to find the enemy, also to guard things, and to locate things like if you needed to get 100 guys across a river, you had to find a place which is called a ford, which will allow you to go across. So finding the enemy, the main job of the cavalry, and every one of them would have a good horse. Some horses were more used to the warfare than others. We'll hear about in a second. This young man, as you can see, is probably the accurate size and age of an actual American Dragoon. The rest of us up here are a little bit too old. The average age for an American Dragoon was about 16 to 20 years old. The really old guys were 22 to 25. Who's 22 here? 22? You could be in charge. Oh, you're not. You're 23. Man, why do they use young men in the Dragoons?
They use young men for the Dragoons because maybe they went inside playing in the woods with their friends, or they went hunting with their fathers, and maybe they didn't have maps or iPhones where you can just go on GPS and find where they're going. So they use little kids, well, not little kids, but they use teenagers to be able to guide these people.
What he meant to say was strong, athletic, intelligent young men. Yeah, right. But what kind of iPhone did George Washington have? He didn't have one. But just like he said, they didn't know the area. So if they used and impressed the young kids, what were the other two roles they'd use it for?
They're used for guiding, or they could just easily take them right back to where the British are and we can be able to attack them.
So the local knowledge, since there were no maps, like Brandon said, it was terribly important to have guides and scouts that would serve in the cavalry that could ride out, and you'll see that in the battle, that they'll ride out, find where the enemy is, and they come back and report. Now, one of the most difficult things in the American Revolution with the cavalry was not all the horses are fit to be soldier horses or cavalry horses. A lot of times, horses would come right off the racetrack. Colonial racing, horse racing, was very popular, still is today. We have Colonial Downs just down the road. As a matter of fact, Trooper Wyko has a horse that's just off the racetrack. He's trying to train this horse, had it be cavalry horse, but running fast is a lot different than explosions and gunfire and all that stuff. Rob, tell us about that.
Yeah, you probably noticed she's a little bit different than the walker horses. They've got this even trotting gait, and she prefers to canter up tight. But anyways, the first time she's fresh off the racetrack, along with another one of the horses, her racing name was Cape and Soup, and she was a stakes race, very high race. So today is her first exposure to gunfire. She did pretty well. First time I drew a saber on her, I ended up on the ground. But I'm hoping today that I'll be able to slice a cabbage. So it takes patience, a lot of reassurance, and again, their natural instinct is to run from swords and guns. Not so they've got to have ultimate trust in you and comfort of the other horses. And the reason that thoroughbreds weren't highly prized was because they're so high energy, they eat a lot of food, and there wasn't a lot of forage, you know, during the winters and tough months. In fact, Washington at one point left his horses loose rather than have them starve. And he was a big avid racer, and he had several horses. If you come to Mount Vernon, you'll see Cajun Soup portraying one of Washington's horses called Blueskin. And you see Blueskin in the museum at Mount Vernon, which is a white gelding.
Great, thank you. Now, the next thing we want to talk about is the weapons. Everybody sees in the movies where the guy on the horse rides up, sees somebody out of a distance, pulls out a pistol, and goes, pow, and shoots him. But Trooper Bob is going to tell us, Trooper Simpson, to tell us how accurate that is. And he's going to tell us why he's dressed in a green uniform. Bob, go ahead.
This is pretty much a cavalry pistol. It's big, it's bulky. It's really only good for one thing, and that's beating them like a club. In order to accurately, I mean, even be close to having a chance, they say you used to have to touch it to yourself, the person you're trying to shoot. Because when you're riding at a gallop or even a trot, you got a pistol that's semi-accurate to maybe 10 feet, and you're doing this, it's really no point. So they used to, each trooper used to get issued five rounds of ammunition. At the end of about six 6 months, that same ammunition would go bad, so they'd have to trade it in. They very rarely shot their pistols. They also had carbines, which was basically a shortened musket. There again, same thing. It's really not accurate. I mean, it can be at times if you practice time to time. But really, their main weapon was, anybody know?
Saber.
Saber, that's correct.
Or bayonet.
This is their main weapon. There's two types. You got a curved saber, and then you got a straight saber. Okay. Those are mainly good for stabbing. You ride up to them, you stab it in, and then you pull it out. That's the reason why they're straight. This one is more of a slashing effect. When they ride up, they slash them and all that stuff. One thing you would notice on a lot of horses back then, their ears, especially on the right side, will be a little bit shorter than their left. Well, as you can imagine, in the heat of the battle, the reason why I'm dressed differently, anybody know? Other than I'm a British. Each unit pretty much had their own colors. The Americans, they look pretty much like this, the 1st Virginia. There was also a legion called Lee's Legion. They were American Revolutionary and the cavalry. They dressed almost similar to the British Dragoons. There was a couple of incidences where the Americans actually rode up to a British column as they were marching, and then they turned on them and pretty much slaughtered them all while they were because they didn't know any different. And by the time they figured it out, it was too late. So that's pretty much that's unfortunate.
So the primary weapon for the cavalry was the saber. As he said, the pistols were used a lot for signaling because you couldn't really hit anything going up and down and the weapon not firing very accurately. What was another weapon that the cavalrymen would have? So that's a carbine. Everybody guess? What's your 1,200-pound friend here? It's a good example. At the Battle of Guilford Courthouse, the American cavalry came from behind or to the right of the British at a dead run, about 120 of them, and just literally knocked down all the British soldiers, or most of them. It looked like they'd killed them all. But when they turned around to see what happened, a lot of the British guys stood up. Because like we said, this is 1,200, 1,300 pounds of meat going 20, 30, 40 miles an hour. You can be very brave, but you're still going to get knocked to the ground. So not often did they use the horses for that. Mostly these were scouting or reconnaissance. But as Bob said, the uniforms and the hunting shirts you see a lot of these militia guys wear, the white long shirts, that was a very common uniform. And so it was very difficult on horseback, especially with the Americans wearing almost the same uniform as Bob's got on, to keep the to tell the difference between the different kind of cavalry that were out in the field. So what we're going to try to do for just a second is we're going to show you a little skill at arms demonstration. Great photo opportunity. We're going to gallop down this field. Now some of these horses will do it, some will kind of do it, and some are terrified. So if anybody could do it, please give them a round of applause. We're going to pick these swords, and this horse is a great horse, but he's like 4 years old. He's not afraid of the sword, but getting them to run straight and do all the right stuff, it's a little bit tough. It's like anybody have a four-year-old? Your head is, right? Don't put your finger in the socket, all that stuff. So we're going to come by, and using a sword, we're going to rotate our hands. We're going to come at that cabbage like it's somebody and either stab it with a straight sword or cut it in half, simulating a watermelon, all right, or whatever. But the point of the horse is the horse is going up and down the motion. It sounds strange, but the faster they go, the smoother it is. Because when they're going at a trot, all their feet are hitting the ground at a different moment. And so it's bouncy. So if you have your arm out like this and it's bouncy, you're not going to hit your thing. But here, listen, this is important. But there's a life lesson that goes with this demonstration. So if you worry about what Fluffy here is thinking about, or if you worry too much about, oh, I'm not holding my hand right, or I'm doing whatever, if you take your eyes off the prize, if you take your eyes off that target and start worrying about everything around you, what's the likelihood you're going to hit that thing? Almost zero. But if you fix your eyes on the right thing, don't worry about the sword, look at what you're going to hit, get your hand right in front of your face, and put that sword tip just like it's part of your body, part of who you are, and keep your eyes on a target. You'll hit that thing and pick it right off almost every time, if your horse cooperates to go straight. So we're going to demonstrate that, and also, it's a little bit morbid, but we're going to have some placards laying on the ground with little British soldiers painted on them. The challenge is, if you come by, you don't quite reach the ground, and a lot of times, like I mentioned, the British soldiers get knocked down, or the Americans would, so you have to come by and impale something on the ground with your sword. If you don't keep your saddle locked up and keep your balance right, you'll end up on the sword or on the ground with the guy that you're trying to get rid of. So we're going to try to pick those things up off the ground as well. So if you would, you're welcome to come up close. We're going to run right down the middle of the thing. And like I said, at the end of this, we'll break up into groups and questions. And if you'd like to get your picture taken with any of these fine beasts, we'll be happy to let you do that. All right, so first, I'm going to try it on this young young horse here. Let's see if I can pick off one of these cabins.
Which way are you going to go?
Thank you. Some take life in fishing and in moon. Others take light in their carriage wheels a rolling. Me, I take the life in the juice, oh, the barley, and courting pretty girls in the barn and so early. Push a ring and earn the nod. Back for daddy-o, back for daddy-o, there's whiskey in the jar. Oh, push a ring and earn the nod. Back for daddy-o, back for daddy-o, there's whiskey in the jar. For many a year I've spent all my money on whiskey and beer, but now I've returned with gold in great store, and I never will play the Wild Rover no more, and it's no, nay, never, no, nay, never, no more will I play the Wild Rover. No more. Went to my parents, confessed what I've done, and asked them to pardon prodigal son. You're right, and I never will play the Wild Rover no more, and it's no name. No, nay, never, no more will I play the Wild Rover. Wild Rover, no
more. Awesome. Thanks.